Hi everyone. I'm going to talk to you about learning intuitive physics with neural networks that are aware of 3D geometry and the process of image formation. Whatever I'm going to talk about is joint work with my students Fish, Zian, Adam, Mihir, Shamit. So this is how we address learning of object motion dynamics in the lab. We have our robot, which is usually a Baxter robot or a Sawyer, and then we pick a camera viewpoint that is convenient, usually it's close to overhead, so that we avoid cross-object occlusions, okay? The camera never moves, and the objects rarely get occluded from this viewpoint. And I would say the state-of-the-art method is take the image, detect the objects, every object becomes a node in a graph neural network, and then train your network to predict where the objects will go, okay, in the 2D space. Now here is me trying to do object manipulation in the real world, picking up my cup. I'm an alive agent, and the camera viewpoint changes, okay, and the objects do get occluded. The object get occluded because I didn't pick a convenient camera viewpoint. And often the camera viewpoint will change during training and during test time, even within the same episode, for example. I argue that our current methods that try to learn object motion dynamics cannot handle such changes of the camera viewpoint, because CNNs essentially, or graph neural networks over 2D images, they do not have object permanence. Objects disappear at occlusion when they interfere with other objects. Objects move with camera motion. That's why we try to minimize camera motion and actually have static cameras. And objects change size during zoom in and zoom out. All those problems are results of the entanglement between camera motion and camera viewpoint and scene appearance in 2D images. And this is exactly the problem that we'll try to handle with neural networks that have three-dimensional bottlenecks. So here's a network. It can take an arbitrary number of input frames. That's why we call it recurrent. It repeats the same computation at every frame, but of course you can also imagine some transformer architecture that operates over the different frames to generate the latent state. And the latent state of this network is three-dimensional. Essentially, it's a 4D tensor. X, Y, Z are the three dimensions, and number of channels is the fourth dimension. And this hidden state is updated at every frame using ego motion and ego motion stabilization, ego motion estimation stabilization process. These are the two main differences between those networks that we'll talk about, which we call them geometry-aware recurrent networks, versus, you know, other type of CNNs or 2D RNNs or 2D convolved CNNs, GRUs, so on. So let's see how this works. So essentially those networks try to accept a 2D video stream or a 2.5D, that is RGB or RGBD images, sequence of images, and infer a featurization, a three-dimensional featurization of the scene that the video depicts. And for now, please assume that the images are static, nothing is moving in. So it's just a static scene, and we'll try to come up with a feature map of that scene. So here is a frame that shows a toaster, and what GRNNs will do, it will pass it through some differentiable and projection operation and shoot essentially RGB values or features along rays and instantiate some voxel grid. And this voxel grid is highly incomplete because we just see a single view right now. So we just see a surface essentially, right, of the scene. But here comes a 3D convolutional network whose job is to densify that feature volume. And here comes another frame. The scene hasn't changed, it hasn't moved, but the camera has changed. And again, we pass the second frame through this unprojection, and again, the 3D CNN. And here comes the ego motion estimation process that estimates the 3D rotation and translation between the first time step and the current time step. and we explicitly transform the features to cancel this estimated ego motion before we fuse the map so far and the current frames map. And again, the same thing, the new frame, we instantiate its feature map. Now this feature map that you see and the one we have up on the top of the slide are in different coordinate frames, and here comes the ego stabilization to bring them in the same coordinate frame. So although what comes out of reframe is highly incomplete, this gray thing, the color thing, so basically you need to remember that those are four-dimensional tensors. Just to visualize them, I just do a PCA along the channel dimension, and I keep the three principal components, and I map them into RGB values. Adam specifically did that, not me. But the result of this process is that although things move in the pixel stream, for example, the corner of the toaster changes XY location all the time and changes the location in the corresponding feature map, after ego stabilization, it's all the time in the same place in our latent map of the scene. And we like this because we know that the human brain also has very strong ego stabilization mechanisms. That's why we perceive a very stable world model, despite the fact that our head moves all the time. Just to contrast these GRNNs against 2D models, here comes the same frame sequence. What those models do is we pass them through a CNN, they get the 2D feature map, so we do also this as a first step, but then they just have convolutions and everything is updated convolutionally. And you know, convolutions are just not designed to cancel camera motion. And as a result, the hidden state is contaminated based on how the camera moves as opposed to how the scene looks like, okay? So the corner of the toaster changes XY pixel locations and change the corresponding features, change the location in the 2D feature maps and change their location in the hidden state. And essentially they're all over the place and they're replicated. They interfere with one another. So what are we gonna do with this model? Well, I know that our goal is to learn object motion dynamics, right? That's the title of our talk. But before we do that, we need to have two, let's say, tasks to help us towards that goal. One is 3D object detection. So we'll fit this map and we'll spit out 3D object boxes simply by adapting some state-of-the-art object detector to take 3D feature maps as opposed to 2D as input and spit out 3D boxes as opposed to 2D. And another task, which actually I'm very excited about, but I don't have time to talk about, but you can read it in the papers, is view prediction. So we can train these GRNN networks to predict views, essentially by how to do it. Like here is the map, and then I give you the query viewpoint, you rotate the 3D tensor, and you project, and you generate the corresponding image. And we have tried RGB regression, and we have tried contrastive view prediction. And you know, if you see the papers, you'll see that GRNNs or neural networks that have 3D mentional neural bottlenecks, this specific architectural biases, can generalize much better to scenes they have never seen before. Here I'm showing you how they do for four objects as opposed to two objects, while other networks that trained again for view prediction without our architecture essentially still see two objects. Okay, so the reasons that we're excited about view prediction is that it's a self-supervised task. You don't need human annotations. It's also biologically plausible. So let's assume you have done that. Let's assume that, you know, you took the architecture and you start looking around many scenes and you trained your networks, you trained the weights just by moving around. And then, you know what, you also had some kind of annotations for objects. And for now, our object motion dynamics learning will be supervised. And of course, learning them unsupervised is a valuable avenue for future work, but for now it's going to be supervised. And that's it. So how we're going to use them, we'll take a video sequence again, where it's going to be a robot gripper and an object, and we'll make the map, the 3D feature map of the scene at every frame. We're just going to pass every image independently to our GRNN. We'll detect the object and we'll build our graph neural network on top of those 3D object detections, as opposed to 2D detections. That's it. So we just changed the visual feature space on which those graphs sit, and we'll predict 3D motions and so on. And what you get, which is in our paper in submission, is that you can generalize across camera viewpoints. Unfortunately, I'm just showing one viewpoint here. not only you can generalize across camera viewpoint, but you can also just move around your camera at test time, because the network essentially takes care of the stabilization process. So ours, now here I'm rendering essentially different objects based on the predictions from our model. And you know, they're closer to the ground truth than some baseline that only looks at the XYZ of objects. We also compare against graph networks in the 2D space. To understand what's happening is, here is the view, the single view that you're watching, but the network maps this view to a 3D feature space, which I'm showing to the right. Things look a bit blurry. The problem with GRNNs is that they're very intense memory-wise. So this tensor is right now 64 by 64 by 64 by the number of channels, okay? Now you can handle, what can you handle? You can handle arbitrary objects because your network is doing 3D object detection to create the nodes. And in fact, those 3D detectors are extremely accurate because in 3D is much easier to segment objects. And they have learned a 3D motion prediction model, which is unrolled over time to do model predictive control and push objects to desired locations. And you can change the camera viewpoint. The camera viewpoint at train and test time doesn't need to be the same. Here we haven't shown that, but the camera viewpoint can also change during execution. I'm showing you here what the robot is looking at, okay? Right. So that was a short video about our work on learning intuitive physics and trying to come up with architectures that have object permanence and have basic spatial common sense, and how these are important to learn to predict results of actions. And these are the students that worked on this. The two papers are published that I talked about, so you can find the webpage. The third one, which is actually the graph neural networks on 3D feature tensors, is not archived yet, so you won't be able to to read it, but I think based on the description that I gave, you'll be able to replicate on your own if you like. Yes, please tell us if you have any questions. Thank you for your attention.